यस सर,
आई गेस मुझे पढ़ना।
प्लीज कंटिन्यू।
ओके, सो द सेशन इज द लास्ट बट नॉट द लीस्ट। आई होप ड्यूरिंग द पास्ट 5 days यू हैव एंजॉयड थ्रू आउट द सेशंस, डिफरेंट सेक्शंस ऑफ द प्रोग्राम। अनुपम वॉज कोऑर्डिनेटिंग दिस एक्टिविटी। Incidentally, the first lecture also I started, so it is my pleasure that I am here to complete the event. And after that, we will be having one valedictory session where our Professor Sukumar Nandi is supposed to join, and he will share that particular session. And in between, I think ICAPME will say some important informations we will share with you. Now, so the topic is best practices, guidelines, and SOPs on cybersecurity e-governance. Okay. Now, first is we have to just think over it. Why should we go for this kind of discussion? What is the requirement? Then where this could be utilized or performed, and what is the mechanism of performing such best practices for the government sector essentially, if we talk, and for that matter any organizations as well. Just as I said, that why best practices, guidelines and standards are required in e-governance environment. Then we'll discuss about where should these be implemented in an organization, and what are those best practices and guidelines. Obviously, along with some standard operating procedures, that also will be discussed. Now, yes, so e-governance is basically a structure of relationship and processes in place to provide direction and control to achieve the mission's goal in an ethical and responsible manner, while balancing risk versus return over IT and its process. We are just defining e-governance in this perspective. Definitely, we have some mission for that. That could be essentially the need for full access, an open environment where users have lots of great information and services, and where one can interact electronically. So by that, what we mean, you should have some accessibility, means there should not be any restriction. The environment should be very open and wide, acceptable to anybody. But the users, they will get some information, they may have some services required to be executed, and they should be provided with some services. And obviously, this means of communication should be both ways. Now, yes, obviously we should have some sort of option, call it a button here, system down, close, open passageways to unauthorized hackers. Yes, that's very important. I think you have already gone to those through those sessions where this hacking and all that related activities has already been discussed in detail. So unauthorized hackers should be closed. Crackers and provide access to only authorized users. So our target should be, the governance should be of that nature that it should allow the authorized users only. So we can say one mission of two objectives. Why is it an issue in terms of cybersecurity? Why it is very important in e-governance sector? Yeah, the threats in cyberspace is mainly as we see in this physical world itself. Yeah, obviously fraud, theft and terrorism. You can remember in the first lecture itself, I have tried to highlight some of the issues in terms of threats. Here a little bit that is different. Why, what is the difference? We need to consider some developments. Three important developments could be automation. We can jot down that. Action at a distance possible. Attack technique propagation is getting easier. There are trends that also can be earmarked, like internet-enabled connectivity, wireless networking, mobile computing. So these are the trends, and we have to cope up with that. Making information asset or application becomes more vulnerable. Now, if you talk something a little bit more detail on specific characteristics of e-governance application. Dealing with citizens' information and business data. It caters to the national security. Consequences of breach can be detrimental. Breach, so maybe breach of contract. Needs to comply with legal requirements. Very important. Mostly remote access. That we have seen accessing these days, almost everything is through online. High degree of information sharing. So in almost all the e-governance applications these days, this kind of characteristics are there. Now, what is the challenge? Challenge is we need to balance basically. Balance between sensible investment and reasonable return of investment, compliance with legal requirements, facilitate working with the secure access to information and IT resources, keeping intruders at bay. So we have to do some struggle for keeping the balance for smooth functioning of governance. And improperly managed and vulnerable IT infrastructure can upset this balance. So there lies the problem. What is the need? The need is therefore to implement best practices, guidelines and procedures to manage cybersecurity posture of the organization. In the initial lecture, I have mentioned about the requirement of mission statement, requirement of inclusion of cybersecurity in the mission statement of any organization itself. So here also, we are trying to tell the same story, but in a different way. Here we are trying to tell that if the governance has to act properly, we need to follow the best practices, guidelines and procedures. Once we are aware of the cybersecurity issues. So now we have to cover the where part. Where should these be implemented in some organization? Let's see. We have to talk now in terms of sort of some defense, a guard basically. So defense in depth. Just think in the left side of this diagram is the information asset, and the right part are the different scenarios where the required defense has to be there. We have to create and develop that defense mechanism. Operations and management, firstly. So you see, that is in the outermost circle. Means activity wise, that is outer side. Infrastructure, security, when things are coming a little bit deeper inside, then comes your application security. Finally, you have the information assets, which is the core of this kind of system. This is scattered by the people, process, and technology. What do you call PPT? You can remember I have mentioned about this PPT mechanism. So what do we do? An information assurance concept in which multiple layers of security controls, basically the defense what we are talking of now, are placed throughout an IT system. Strategy is to provide redundancy so that if one layer of defense fails, another layer may work or further delay in the attacks. It can at least delay the attack. So that is also important. We have to provide some redundancy in the system. Now, if we just talk about the a little bit farther ahead in more detail in terms of the defense part, you see that we have infrastructure security, operations and management security, application security in broader perspective. There, for operations and management security, you have the security policy, you have outsourcing management, operational procedures, protection from malware, backup and recovery mechanism, patch and update management, physical and environmental security. That is also important. Training and awareness comes under the area of operations and management security. But most importantly, if we talk about the infrastructure security, their perimeter defense. Essentially, it is basically having that particular stage with perimeter defense, authentication and management, authentication, then management and monitoring. Obviously, configuration of a system, that is very important to have a good defense. Interconnectivity, interconnections through cables, interconnections through wireless LAN, whatever is the case may be. But then you have some deployment and use scenario in terms of application security. So where, say for example, as we have talked about some sort of application website development, so that if you want to go for kind of secured system, you have to look into the deployment part of it and obviously the users, actual users interactions, which includes the application design, data storage and communication part. So overall impact analysis and risk assessment will lead to you a good defense if you go for such e-governance system with cybersecurity in place. So what is the bottom line or the essence of this is implement the best practices, standards, and once again, that is the moral here. Now we'll be just talking about the policies, procedures, and SOPs in national perspective. So first is your national cybersecurity policy. Then comes your IT Act. We have organizations like CERT-IN, you are already aware of. Already many speakers from CERT-IN has talked in past few days. We have NCIIPC, that is your National Critical Information Infrastructure Protection Center. Once again, a government of India organization, and obviously cyber crisis management plan. So these things need to be discussed a little bit more deeply. Now, we are coming to the question of what are some best practices and the guidelines thereof. And naturally, along with that, we should discuss about the SOPs. So in national perspective, the important agencies, important issues, what we have already framed up, that fourth one, the first one is your national cybersecurity policy. Then you have the IT Act with you. Organizations who are implementing things, essentially CERT-IN, NCIIPC, and is backed up by the cyber crisis management plan. If we talk about the national cybersecurity policy, basically that caters to the whole spectrum of ICT users and providers, which can enable secure computing environment and confidence in electronic transactions. Like, see, that policy essentially is prepared in such a way that whatever kind of electronic transactions, maybe say monetary transactions, essentially that there is a guideline given in that policy. And if something goes against that, definitely that will be treated under some provisions of IT Act, and necessary prosecution can be done in future if required. So if you talk about the IT Act, what exactly is its purpose? It can serve an umbrella framework for defining and guiding the actions related to security of cyberspace. Yes, because basically, you know, where in IT Act, it covers whole gamut of your information security and cybersecurity related issues, which can come and which has come over the past many years, and possibly some options for adopting new policies are also there. So that a kind of informations all are covered under this IT Act policy. Now, if you talk about CERT-IN essentially enables individual sectors and organizations in designing appropriate cybersecurity policies. It is computer emergency response team. So what they do if anything sudden outbreak comes in terms of security threats or some sort of cyber attack, they immediately respond to that and try to resolve the issues within no time. But they also guide different sectors individually how to be proactive and take guard before such events are happened. Means some good practices. They provide time to time the updates, patches, whatever is required for your system to be protected, to keep protected, and restricting your network to be hacked by someone outsider. So they're playing very crucial role in this particular area. We have NCIIPC as well. They are also having some critical information infrastructure protection policies. They look after critical infrastructure like, say, defense sector, your power plants, and something of that sort, which are very important for the nation. So those things are also the requirement for them to protect the guidelines, everything, and the action taken for protecting them. That is being governed by this organization. Cyber crisis management plan. In a nutshell, if we talk about it, it gives you, it's basically strengthens you, strengthens the cyber regulatory framework. So the framework what we have discussed are being utilized by certain NCIIPC and similar organizations for such cyber security events protection and online threat, whatever is coming, that also they are looking after continuously 24/7. So those framework is being strengthened by such cyber crisis management plan. There are, you can say, two categories you can just think of. One is normal monitoring situation, where each and every moment your network, your systems are being monitored. If something suddenly found, then it will address towards that. But in some other situation where suddenly an outbreak happens, then we say that it's basically a crisis situation. So there, you know, this kind of cyber crisis management plan will help you if you have gone for that, if you have implemented your system, if you have a guard using this particular kind of management planning, then you can just protect your system from such untoward events. Yes, so the little bit more detail about the each and every part of it, if we talk, then the vision for national cybersecurity policy could be, is basically to build a secure and resilient cyberspace for citizens, business, and government. Its mission is to protect information and information infrastructure in cyberspace, building capabilities to prevent and respond this kind of cyber attacks, reducing the vulnerability, minimizing the damage from cyber incidents. Sometimes definitely you are you won't be able to prevent everything, so it can damage your system, but at least this kind of policy will help you in minimizing the damage through a combination of institutional structure, people, process, and technology with proper cooperation and coordination. There are 14 objectives for this. What is it? Assurance framework, regulatory framework, and regulatory framework. Then you have NCIIPC, tested and validated products, law for cybercrime, capacity building, effective PPP model. These all are coming under that objectives. They have got a strategy for creating resource, secure ecosystem, supporting the use of assurance and open standards, very important. And just before my talk, there was a lecture on OWASP, you have seen that. So that also is very crucial that we have to see that open standards here. Threat management mechanism, promote R&D, manage supply chain risk, and training and awareness is essential part of such organization's policies strategy. Now, if you just go a little bit more detail on IT Act, what it covers. Anyway, IT Act, we cannot go into the much of the details here. That takes a lot of time itself, is a huge topic, and I believe it has already been discussed in some of the lectures. I'm just touching upon the important issues. It's essentially governing the law, governing law for cybercrime and electronic commerce, e-commerce as we know by popular name. Primary objectives are legal recognition to all transactions which has been done through electronic data exchange, communication or e-commerce mechanism. Recognition legally for a digital signature for the authentication purposes. We have e-sign kind of software for that also. Facilitating the electronic filing of documents, electronic storage of data, and so on and so forth. Legal sanctioning and facilitating the electronic transfer of fund, recognition to bankers for keeping the books of account in electronic form. That also comes under this. Certain key important features can be worth mention is features of IT Act, which addresses the important issues of security critical to success for electronic transactions. It oversees the implementation of its various provisions through elaborative machinery, that is controller, cyber applet, and etc. It can prevent the cyber crime, specifies laws and penalties for cyber crime and offenses, like through prosecution. Certain, yes, it was first started under the Section 70B Information Technology Act as per that 2000, which designates CERTIN as the national nodal agency to tackle emerging challenges in the area of cybersecurity risks and essential missions of this organization is to enhance the security of India's communications and information infrastructure through proactive action and effective collaboration. Some of the roles in CERTIN would be computer security incident response. It is both way, reactive and proactive. Means if situation happens, then it is reactive. And before the situation happens, prediction analysis and continuous monitoring, that is coming under the proactive activity. Security quality management services. Information exchange with sectoral CERT, that is CSIRTs, CIOs of critical infrastructure. Organizations, ISPs and vendors, they exchange with these kind of organizations. At different states, now CERTs are being developed because the central CERT is overloaded and quick response is essential. The incidences are coming up, happening in a very large volume these days. So CSIRTs are being developed. As a matter of fact, CIDAC is once again working in that area, and CIDAC Kolkata is developing such CSIRTs, that is CERT, for state government of Jharkhand. International collaboration. Member of FIRST, member of APCERT, research partner APWG, and functional relationship with other CERTs, US CERT, CERT-CC, and JP CERT, etc. If we talk about NCIIPC, we have certain missions there also. Essentially, I have mentioned that it is for critical infrastructure sector. So it does a lot of things here. They have mentioned policy and strategies. They guide principles and responsibilities. Facilitate the identification of CIIs in conjunction with CIE organizations, critical infrastructure organizations, production of CII through a risk management approach, They develop capability for real-time warning system. They have BAPTM malware analysis ensuring. They are having basically sharing of information on emerging threats, cyber attacks and vulnerabilities, sharing information security breach, incident, cyber attack and espionage, lead and coordinate the national program and policy on CII, establish national and international linkage initiatives, promotes indigenous R&D relating to protection of CII and such and more, many more things they are having under their umbrella. There are 35 best practices defined against five family of controls. One is planning control, then implementation control, third is operational control, fourth one, disaster recovery or business continuity plan. We'll talk a little bit more detail on this, BCP control, and reporting and accountability control. You can just see that this is basically the main controls that has been talked about. So starting from here, the planning control, then you have the implementation control, operational control, reporting and accountability, and then you have the disaster recovery, all this. Finally, the reporting and accountability. Cyber crisis management. What is the purpose of it? The purpose was to establish the strategic framework and guide actions to prepare for and respond to coordinate a recover from a cyber incident. It ensures the interruption of critical function in critical sector, infrequent, manageable, and which can basically minimize the damage. It helps in putting in place the mechanism which can effectively deal with the cybersecurity crisis and identify responsibility and accountability. It aims for a secure, vigilant, and resilient organization. The mandate of this particular organization is Ministry of the Department of Central and State Government and Union Territories to draw up their own cyber crisis management plan, equip themselves for implementation, monitoring and supervising such implementation process, and then complying, means ensure the compliance. CERTIN or METI, that is our parent body, Ministry of Electronics and IT, to conduct mock drills. METI to seek necessary compliance information on implementation of the best IT security practices from ministries or department of central and state government and union territories on a regular basis. They have given some guidelines, which are the plan which shall take into consideration the crisis that occurred due to cyber security incidents and breaches. It shall present a broad-based approach to deal with such crises. It should not use only for responding to the cyber crisis or incident, but it should guide in building the cyber resiliency at each and every organization and sector level. Plans should be updated periodically by CERTIN to take into account the dynamic nature of cybersecurity threat and the emerging technology. Now we are coming to the standards. There are certain standards depicted over here. We'll talk a little bit brief in this. ISO 27001, ISO 22301, NIST SP830, ISO 20000, NIST Cybersecurity Framework, Supply Chain Risk Management, that is NIST Guidelines, ISO 28000. These are certain standards which are coming under the purview of this particular topic. So basically 27001, we'll talk a little bit here. It is basically ISO IEC 27001-2013, which specifies the requirement. You can say it is for ISMS policy. It specifies the requirement for establishing, implementing, maintaining, and continually improving an information security management system which I just talking now, ISMS, that is Information Security Management System, within the context of a organization. It varies organization to organization, structure to structure, but there is an overall guideline which can be adopted by each and every organization. In fact, these days it is becoming essential to implement the ISMS policy. It also includes requirements for the assessment and treatment of information security risk tailored to the needs of such organization. The requirements set out in ISO IEC 27003 are generic and are intended to be applicable for all organizations regardless of type, size or nature. It may be a big organization, it may be a scientific organization, it may be a non-scientific organization, whatever it is. It is generic in nature, so it is applicable to any organizations. There are 14 domains and 114 controls depicted under this particular ISO guideline. The controls, some of the controls are being cropped in here, which would be of interest. That is information security policy. There are two controls. Under certain domains, it comes up. Organization of information security, you have 7 controls. Human resource security, there are some 6 controls which are applied before, during, or after the employment. Asset management, there are 10 controls. Access control, it's very crucial. There are 14 controls. Cryptography, already I think you have come across, a little more detail has been discussed in, I think, 2 to 3 lectures. There are 2 controls in this. Physical and environmental security, you have 15 controls. Operation security, there are 14 controls. Communication security, similarly, you have 7 controls. You have system acquisition, development and maintenance, 13 controls. Supplier relationships, 5 control. Information security incident management. So that caters to 7 controls. Information security aspects of business continuity management and compliance with internal requirements such as policies and with external requirements like law. So there are also some controls are there. So the overall plan can be categorized in these verticals, like context of some organizations has to be first gone through while preparing such plan, leadership, planning, and context of the organization, where you have the first, you have to understand the organization and its context. Expectations of interested parties are to be put in place. Scope for ISMS has to be properly written down or jotted down. Then you will get that particular ISMS policy. Leadership policy, there you have the leadership and commitment part. Policy is being integrated with it, where the organizational roles and responsibilities are very crucial. And based on that, only leadership and commitment and need and its importance can be depicted. In terms of planning, you have actions to address the risk and opportunities, and information security objectives and plans to achieve them also has to be kept in mind. Now, just to execute that, you need a support. What are the supports that are normally required for executing such plan? Are obviously the resources, competence of the persons who are involved in that, awareness. Yes, that awareness from the developer side that we are actually planning the thing, as well as it should reflect users end as well. Communication, and essentially very crucial, is documented information So each and every information has to be properly emphasized, that word properly, properly documented. So how to go about? What are the steps to take for take it further? So we have to think doing it, then you have to check certain things and then act. Doing part, basically the operation side. There some planning is required, like operational planning and control. Information security risk assessment. Yes, that's very, very important part of it. Information security risk treatment. So step by step. First, you have some planning, operational, how your organization is operating, you note it down properly, and then you try to assess the risk of any information which is being floating throughout the organization, in and out. Obviously, when you can assess a particular risk, there are some guidelines for that. What are the things that need to be checked in? Checklists are there available for it. Once you do that, it has to be done very thoroughly, and each and every component, like even a small your system, your beyond your computer system, there are a lot of other issues also. You have to think about it, through which the information can be passed on. So we have to take that part as a risk. Yes, the risk has got certain weightage. Some risk may be of higher weightage, some may be of middle weight, some may be of lower weightage. But you have to do this exercise meticulously. Assess it properly. Then you have to treat it accordingly. For the higher risk information systems, where you need to take guard, you have to give more protection, maybe some sort of, even in some cases of like your defense sector, you need isolations as well, so that it is layered and information passing from one system to the other is prohibited. So that is an extreme situation. But in normal organizations, you may have a requirement of high risk zone, like say, for example, your network systems information, your accounts department's information. So those things are very crucial, very important. So those things you need to protect properly. For that, you need to have some policy for information security risk treatment. Then comes your performance evaluation. So you have to check that. Monitoring, measurement, analysis, and evaluation. So you have some system you have put in place. You have to continuously monitor that, analyze it, and evaluate the situation. Internal audit, management review has to be done accordingly. Then finally, to improve, non-conformity and corrective action has to be taken. Continual improvement is also important. Hello. अच्छा हमें तो लेक्चर है ऐसे कॉल करना है. So sorry. Now we are going to the other standard called ISO 22301. What is that basically? It is basically your business continuity management system standard. It specifies the requirement to plan, establish, implement, operate, monitor, review, maintain, and continually improve a documented management system to protect against, reduce the likelihood of occurrence, prepare for, respond to, and recover from disruptive incidents when they arise. Steps could be like this. There are certain clauses mentioned over here. Business continuity plan exercising and testing. This is the first part of it, where clause 8.5 is there. Planning and control of operations is having these two. One side you have this, other side business continuity strategy selection, which is being guided by the business continuity procedure establishment and implementation. Clause 8.4 and 8.3. What are the benefits of such business continuity management system standards? Identify and manage the current and future threats to your business. Take a proactive approach to minimizing the impact of incidents. keep critical functions up and running during times of crisis. Minimize downtime during incidents and improve recovery time. Very important. This is possible only when you have the 24/7 continuous monitoring and analysis together. Demonstrate resilience to customers, suppliers, and for tender requests. So this will give the impact, basically a kind of benefit if you maintain such standard. Next, if we talk about NIST 830, NIST, as you know, is a National Institute of Standards and Technology. So they have published certain guidelines, some standards. The purpose of special publication 830, we are taking that particular one, is to provide guidance for conducting risk assessment, which is relevant to our discussion today, of federal information systems and organizations. It provides guidance for carrying out each of the certain steps, like important three steps for risk assessment process. First one is preparing for the assessment, then conducting the assessment, and finally maintain that assessment. Yes, so the guidelines basically here, it's very crucial, and this is being followed everywhere for ISMS policy implementations. Step one is prepare for assessment, which is derived from organizational risk frame. Then conduct the assessment. Here you have some expanded task views, like identify the threat sources and events. How you do this assessment, how you conduct the assessment exercise. First, identify the threat sources and events. Then identify vulnerabilities and predisposing conditions. Next, determine likelihood of occurrence. Determine magnitude of impact. For example, like what could be the problem if some of your system is being compromised. So what could be the magnitude? That also has to be assessed. Determine the risk above all. So then comes your step three for communication results. Whatever you have done, this assessment has to be properly communicated. Step four is maintaining the assessment. Now, if we talk about ISO 20000, then we have certain things under this particular umbrella as well. Once again, it has certain guidelines. International standards for, it is essentially the international standards for IT service management, which describes an integrated set of management processes for the effective delivery of services to the business and its customers. So why to go for this implementation of ISO 20000? This can provide organization with the means to operate more effectively and more efficiently. It can basically provide an auditable method through which you can assess the quality and conformity of IT services. It can provide structured framework effectively. So that we can effectively manage the IT services to meet the business or customer requirement. It can improve the effectiveness of IT and promotes consistent delivery of IT services. It improves IT performance and service reliability. It inculcates a process-driven approach for providing IT services. A little bit more detail, pictorially, we can provide this information to you, that service management system, what is called SMS, you have design and transition of new services, you have service delivery process as well. So on the left, you see that under the service management system, you have the components like resource management, documentation management, establish and improve the SMS, governance of process, management responsibility, and so on and so forth. under the head of design and transition of new services, obviously the transition planning and support are very crucial. Service delivery process, you have service reporting, you have financial management system, you have capacity management, you have information security management, which is obviously a very essential part of this discussion, and availability management. Yes, as you know that your whatever is required at right point of time, your system should be able to provide that particular information. So comes under that availability. So you should have a management plan for that as well. Service continuity management. Yes, if you are providing a service, particular service, maybe some website is up and running through your say web server. So that service continuity has to be properly addressed. So there should not be any disruption. For example, you need to operate your data center without any flaw 24/7. Because through your data center, you can provide such many such services to many other organizations as well as your own organizations. Service level management is definitely another important issue. Then comes your relationship process, resolution process, and control process. For relationship process, you have the issues like business relationship management and supplier management. For resolution, you have problem management, you have incident management. So you have to be a little bit more tricky in handling this kind of situation, how to manage a particular incident. Control process, release and deploy management, configuration management, and change management. So these are very standard terminologies. Normally, organizations of any good structure, they are maintaining such things like configuration management and change management. Adapts to the change of any system. Now, so if we talk about NIST cybersecurity framework, you can start with the policy, like you can have the components like identify, protect, detect, respond, and recover. So identify is what process and assets need protection. Protect is implement appropriate safeguards to ensure protection of the assets and ensure delivery of critical infrastructure and services. Detect, implement appropriate mechanism to identify the occurrence of such incidents. Respond, you have to respond towards the developed technologies to contain the impact of the incidents. Recover, implement the appropriate process to restore the capabilities and service impaired due to cyber crisis incidents. So overall, NIST cybersecurity network security framework, you have all this: identity, protect, detect, respond, and recover. All these things what I have already discussed are coming under this umbrella. You have asset management, business management, governance, risk management strategy, supply chain risk management, and all that. You have identity, authentication, access control, awareness, data security, information protection, process maintenance, proactive, and so on and so forth. So this, anyway, people have to abide by. For detection, you have the unauthorized access and data breaches. You have to take guard of that. Respond, you have to see, you have to respond to the cyber attacks and events, as already we have discussed over, and obviously normal operations and services has to be resumed after such incidences have happened. So there are certain things called cyber supply chain security. So there are key supply chain risks would be third party service providers or vendors, physical or virtual access, poor confirmation information security practices by lower tier supplier, compromised software or hardware purchased from supplier. The reasons could be software security vulnerability in supply system, counterfeit hardware or hardware with embedded malware. Already something has come with original thing. Third party data storage and data aggregators. You have all these RFPs and all that stuff. I'm not going to that details. You can see that the supply chain security has got a lot of things, a lot of issues to be covered up. And at this stage, I think I should stop. And any questions, you are most welcome. And thank you for listening. I think I have to stop here. Yes.
Thank you, sir. I believe, sir, there are a few questions in the chat.
Okay. Yeah, you can address that, I believe. Open standards in CCMP and BCP. Okay. That I am not sure. This I cannot right now give the details about that. CCMP and BCP. CCMP, we have discussed a brief about that. Open standards, we need to go into the details. I think what could be done at this stage, if some queries are there, they can just mail us. We can pass it on to Mithali Madam so that further detailing can be done on that. You can take the note of this particular part. Okay.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much. We'll forward the questions to the concerned expert regarding that. Total technical sessions, we come to an end for this 5-day training program. Sir, we'll hear now, we'll have a break for 5 minutes and we'll join, everybody requested to join for valedictory session.